The British Isles lie in sometimes temperate and sometimes tempestuous weather off the coast of Europe. There, among the highlands and islands of Argyll in Scotland, we bring you an introduction to one aspect of Scottish Highland history and heritage. Welcome to Argyll, the southwestern part of the Scottish Highlands and Islands. You're invited to come on a journey to take a brief look at one aspect of how this physically poor yet culturally rich area evolved since earlier times, and then to explore the evolution of one extended family or kindred who came to be most influential here from the 1400s to the 1800s. A few of these people were ruthless, yet most were creative. This exploration is intended as an all-inclusive panorama, and not to pump the pride of one family or attack or demean any other. We're looking at one facet of history here, one pebble in the mosaic of evolving Highland, Scottish, British, European life, and now also a part of the cultural heritage of Australasia, North America, and beyond. Aspects of this history and the culture it produced have influenced people wherever Scots or their descendants have spent their lives. I hope you can enjoy the magnificent scenery of Argyll and other parts of Scotland, which is a background to the little-known facts presented here. First, we will look briefly at the evolution of the land and the early people of Argyll as a background for later history. This will bring us to the period of some five centuries when Argyll was most influenced by the Campbells in particular. Argyll, or Dalriada as it was earlier known, has been called the cradle of the Scottish race and, perhaps due to two or three dominating figures among the Campbell chiefs and chieftains, some Scots feel strongly about the Campbells, who for eight centuries have made Argyll their home. Inevitably, in a medium such as this, ours will be a simplified overview of a highly complex and intriguing subject. The landscape of Argyll has a glorious variety. Ancient violence and later steady shifts exploded, heaved, and layered the varied rocks. And then the Ice Age came, scraping and gouging the glens and lochs as impacted layers of glaciers ground their way to the sea. Only the peaks rose into the Arctic air, sere and glittering with ice or whited out by blizzards. In time, the warmer waters of the Gulf Stream came, and among the sound of crashing ice and running waters, the glaciers retreated. Then the first people came. We can tell by the kind of fish they caught that they came up the coast by sea, perhaps in craft of skin or hollowed logs. The debris of their meals is piled in middens by their caves where they camped for a season each year. No doubt they told impressive fishing stories even then. Although Argyll is as far to the north as Hudson's Bay, the warm seas of the Gulf Stream melting the ice created so much moisture that wherever ice-carved debris lay, a rampant growth of forest sprung up, soon to be smothered in turn by moss and fern. As vegetation died, the detritus formed a blanket of peat across the land, covering hills and washing into lochs to form deep bogs. Here on Rannoch Moor, once covered by a mother dome of glaciers carving out Glen Coe, Glen Etive, and Glen Orchy, the peat lies thick upon the land, a handsome, untamed wilderness reaching to the horizon. Eons later, in Neolithic times, the first farmers drove their herds through the passes into Argyll, nurturing their meager crops in clearings in the woods. In time, they built these massive chambered burial cairns, a sign of a larger and well-organized population, and set up standing stones, some perhaps to help determine the solstice for their agricultural calendar. Some of their chiefs or priests wore great collars of jet, which have been found in their graves. From their time onward, there were cattlemen in Argyll, although few remain today. DNA mapping suggests that some local people could claim descent from these first settlers and other farmers in Argyll. As the Iron Age replaced the Bronze, bands of warriors came with their more easily produced iron swords. In time, their culture came to dominate. Perhaps it was the pressure of these times and of the later Roman presence driving the tribes away from their influence in the south, which produced the need for numerous forts and duns, which crown the rocky outcrops in Argyll. Until the 20th century, there were two types of farms in Argyll, individual and communal, remnants of differing cultures. The forts were larger and built to be used as places of refuge with their herds by whole communities. The duns were often smaller and used as homes and farmsteads by extended family groups, probably of the warrior kindred. Some of these were occupied into the 15th century or later. As we come to the time of early recorded history in Argyll, the population could have been a blend of Neolithic peoples absorbing waves of incomers. Some of the people have been called Pict, but the last ripple of the long westward movement of the Celtic peoples were known as Scots and were kin to those in Northern Ireland. This is Argyll today, earlier called Dalriada, the cradle of the Scottish nation when, from 500 AD, the spiritual influence of St. Columba inspired some of the native Picts and his kinsfolk, the incoming Scots or Dalriadic people. His community of the spirit was founded upon the island of Iona. They learned to find and experience inner peace in a violent time, were seemingly non-judgmental, and were accepting and at one with other people in the natural world. Their style of Christianity appears to have been spiritual rather than religious, less interested in human control and with barely a framework of organization. Their idea of progress was to release people from their inner bonds of fear so that they could be who they were meant to be. The temporal seat of the Dalriadic kings was here at Dunad, in what would later become the district of Glasserie in Mid-Argyll. This is Dunad up here, and this is the main entrance gate, a natural fissure in the rock which the prehistoric people used as the entrance to the fort. Dunad is one of the most significant fortresses in Argyll. In about 500 AD, the sons of Fergus, son of Erc, one of whom who was known as Lorne, came to this part of what is now Argyll and created a new kingdom called Dalriada.
St. Columba is said to have inaugurated one of the Dalriadic kings here. A cup in the rock is believed to have held oil or water for the blessing or anointing. Later still, from the time of Kenneth MacAlpin, who began to unite Scot and Pict in the 830s, the seat of power would move from Dunad to Dunstaffnage, and later, driven by raids of the Norsemen, it was moved inland to Dunkeld in Perthshire. In the 8th century, Norse raids on Iona would result in some monks returning to Ireland, taking with them their surviving treasures, like the Book of Kells. Meanwhile, the administrative seat of the church was moved here with the court to Dunkeld. The vacuum left by the departure of the seat of power from Dalriada or Argyll is said to have been filled in part when Kenneth MacAlpin invited over from Ireland a warrior kindred to help him deal either with the Picts or more likely still with the Norse invaders. 2 centuries later, the leaders of this warrior kindred were ousted by the Norse king Magnus Barefoot, or Barelegs, said to be of part Irish ancestry, who came rampaging down the coast from the north with a fleet of galleys, destroying the communities and claiming that all the isles were his to rule. The defeated Rí, or local king of isles in Argyll, was known as Gilibride of the Cave for his homeless status. He had a son called Somerled, part Norse, part Irish in ancestry, an heroic figure ever after. He drove the Norse and their king of man from Morven, Lorne, and the islands of Argyll, and created 3 dynasties in part of Argyll and the Isles, the first of these being the ancestors of Clan Dougal, the lords of Argyll and the Isles. Even before the time of Somerled, an Irish prince, Unrahan, had married an heiress of a ruler in Argyll, and his descendants came to govern the districts of Napdale, Cowl Slate, now northern Kintyre, Glassery, and Cowell, all in Argyll. A grandson of Unrahan was Sweyn na Rua, or Sweyn the Red.
This is Castle Sweyn on Loch Sweyn, one of the earliest stone-built castles of its kind in Scotland, if not the earliest. And it was built by Sweyn, or Swain, who was a member of a family descended from Unrahan, who was an Irish prince who came over here in about 1050. And in the 1400s, it came into the hands of the Earl of Argyll, thanks to a grant from the king.
The father of Sweyn na Rua would have been a contemporary of Somerled, ruling the southern and eastern parts of Argyll, with the exception of southern Kintyre. Another of his family built the first castle here at Skipness in Cowl Slate, now known as the northern part of Kintyre. Others of the Unrahan MacSween kindred were ancestors of the MacGilchrists of Finchan in Glassery, the MacLachlans of Castle Lachlan, and the Lamonts of Ard Lamont in Cowl. Commanding what is now known as Oban Bay stands the ancient dun or fort upon which Dunolly Castle of the MacDougalls would later be built. From the earliest times and in the days of Somerled from about 1100 until his death in 1163, these seaways were the main routes for governance and trade. Here, the earlier stronghold at Dunolly commanded a most vital junction of these seaways, the routes from the Great Glen in the northeast down Loch Linney, from the north and west down the Sound of Mull, from Iona and the Atlantic in the west, up from the Sound of Jura in the southwest, and even from eastern Scotland by Loch Awe and Loch Etive. Here at Dunolly, all these routes crossed or converged, and here, doubtless, Somerled had one of his most vital strongholds. When he was killed while attacking the King of Scots in 1163, this area of Lorne, Morven, and the Isles, including Mull and much of Jura, passed to his eldest surviving son, Dougal, whose descendants would be Rí or Lords of Argyll and the Isles until 1308. Their descendants would be Clan Dougal of Dunolly. The younger sons of Somerled were left with the peripheral lands and islands of Garmoran, Ardnamurchan and northwards, Isla with part of Jura, Colonsay and southern Kintyre. The island of Kerrer, now still in the hands of the descendants of the MacDougall lords of Argyll, was where, in 1249, King Alexander II died on an expedition to bring to his loyalty Ewan, then lord of Argyll and the Isles. In 1263, Ewan was loyal enough to the King of Scots to resist fully joining King Magnus of Norway on his way to attack Scotland at the Battle of Largs. A gale contributed to Magnus' defeat. The Isles, which had been nominally under Norwegian rule since the time of Magnus Barefoot or Barelegs in the late 1000s, were subsequently returned to Scotland by the Treaty of Perth in 1266. Duncan MacDougall, grandson of Somerled, was a contemporary of his younger cousin Donald of Isla, another grandson of Somerled, from whom Clan Donald would take its name. Duncan, son of Dougal, lord of Argyll and the Isles, is said to have built this castle of Dunstaffnage in Argyll. After 1308, Sir Arthur Campbell was made constable of the castle for the king. Duncan also founded the Priory of Ardhattan further up Loch Etive. Here, under surviving arches of what is now the dining room, Robert Bruce is said to have held a parliament, or gathering of the leadership of Argyll, following the Battle of the Pass of Brander in 1308. It would remain a priory until the Reformation of 1560, although latterly the lay priors were Campbells of Corder. Within a century of the death of Somerled, the first of the O'Duin appear on record using the name Campbell. In those days, it was spelt C-A-M-B-E-L. Sir Gillespie Campbell, who died in about 1281, could well have known Somerled's younger grandson, Donald of Isla, from whom Clan Donald would later take its name. Donald died in the mid-1200s. Although the Gaelic oral tradition suggests the conjecture that the O'Duin ancestors of the Campbells were established on Loch Awe by the visit of King Alexander II in 1222, it is only in the late 1200s that they are found on record here on Loch Awe in Argyll, 35 miles as the eagle flies to the west of Dumbarton. Due to the fighting in Argyll during the Wars for Independence of the early 1300s, few earlier charters of any families in the area survive, so that the records are not there to support the Gaelic tradition. The first of the family to leave physical evidence of his presence on Loch Awe was Sir Colin Moore Campbell, Caelan Moore in the Gaelic. He is said to have been killed during a border dispute in 1296. He was felled by a MacDougall arrow on the spot marked by this cairn on the height of the String of Lorn, an ancient way between Loch Awe and the sea at Loch Fiachan. His father, Sir Gillespie Campbell, appears on record in 1260, and his mother was first cousin to the mother of Robert Bruce. Sir Colin had been knighted about the time of his father's death in 1281, and for the rest of his life was involved with national affairs. This cousinship with the Bruce would determine Campbell loyalties for generations. From Colin's name, the Campbell chiefs take their Gaelic patronymic title, MacCallan More, son of Great Colin. Here at Inverara Castle on Loch Fyne, the direct descendant of Kellan More makes his home. Torquil Campbell, Duke of Argyll, is chief of Clan Campbell. His father, the 12th Duke, who died in 2001, gave this introduction.
As you've seen, the elder parts of this land we live in, that go back to the very dawn of prehistory. Our vast global family is ever conscious of its history, ever conscious of its successes, as well as at times its failures. And it's only by realizing these at all times that we can look forward to a future which will be of benefit to all of us. Our population at home is in excess of 5.5 million, which is minuscule compared to the number of Scots that we have on a global basis. And it emphasizes the point that has been so oft made that the greatest export that Scotland has ever produced is indeed its people. Behind me is what we term a relatively modern building. It was started in 1741. It is a grandiose palace that was started by the third Duke of Argyll and is very much lived in today by my family and myself. And I emphasize that it is the world headquarters of our vast tribe. Now, all tribes, all clans are important to those people who adhere their loyalty to that particular family. Some, sadly, don't have as grand a headquarters as ours, and we're not smug about it. But we must remember that not all Campbells that exist came from this house. In fact, a very far greater proportion of all Campbells came from much humbler dwellings, but certainly probably produced far greater people than those that this house begot. Over the next few minutes, you will be visiting, with the aid of vision, a host of places in Scotland, some of which, sadly, I have yet to see myself. I very much hope that you enjoy and you learn from what you are about to see the very great history of Scotland.
Why examine the Campbells in particular? Some Scots were brought up to hate the Campbells. When asked why, some would mention the massacre of Glencoe, not knowing that it was entirely a government atrocity and in no way part of a clan dispute. Others remember the old Highland prayer, "From the greed of the Campbells deliver us." Few Highland families grew so fast and so produced such strength of feeling. What we're looking at here is, how did that come about? Defining who we are by whom we hate is an idea as old as the hills. And yet in this ever-shrinking world community today, it is a toxic idea and poisons whoever holds it. So it might just as well be thrown into the hazardous waste disposal. Yet this strong feeling about the Campbells, is it based on fact or on old Jacobite propaganda or partly on the literature of people like Sir Walter Scott, Robert Louis Stevenson, or other writers about the Highlands, or even on tourist literature? These questions give ample reason to examine the kindred in more detail. Who were the Campbells? Where did they come from? Did they also suffer? And how did they grow to such strength?
Here on the ancient rock at Dunbreton, the fort or dun of the Britons, now oddly anglicized to Dumbarton, the Gaelic bards describe an early ancestor of the Campbells being born in Antaladerg, or the Red Hall of the Britons. If their genealogies could be confirmed, this birth could have taken place in the late 1000s. The boy's father is said to have been called Arthur, a name still living then in legend from 5 centuries before, when a force of Britons of Celtic culture, led by one Arthur, were defeated by the Saxons at a place called Badon. Just as, in 1066, the Saxons themselves were defeated by the Gallic Norse, or Normans, at a place called Hastings. In 1066, Dunbreton was the seat of the rulers of the Kingdom of Strathclyde. Earlier, in about the year 500, when St. Columba came to Iona, the Brittonic Celts of Strathclyde were likely a mixed people. Picts to the north in the Lennox about Dunbreton, which had been north and west of the Roman Antonine Wall. Up the Clyde, the descendants of those local tribes influenced by Christianity and Rome. Later on, some Norse and Irish invaders along the coast to the south. But predominantly, the people spoke what we would now call a Welsh Celtic language. Interestingly, the earlier names of the O'Duin pedigree before the Arthur in the Red Hall are in this pre-Gallic, Brittonic Celtic tongue, lending credence to the remnants of reality. At times, the Kingdom of Strathclyde extended south as far as Cumbria, now the English Lake District, but by 1066, the influence of the Dalriadic leadership of the Scots had brought the people of actual Strathclyde, the watershed of the River Clyde, firmly into the fold of the Gael, and they were Gaelic speakers, and no doubt with their own different dialect. The name used for the Campbells in the Gaelic persisted as the O'Duin as long as they were mentioned by Gaelic speakers. Here in the Lennox, just to the east of Argyll, there is a Duin on record as a witness in 1133. Was he perhaps the original O'Duin? We may never know. Professor Barrow, the expert on Robert Bruce, commenting upon the marriage of Gillespie Campbell to a granddaughter of the Earl of Carrick in the mid-1200s, wrote of the Campbells that they were certainly not landless adventurers. Historian David Seller has asked whether, in the late 1200s, before concentrating their power about Lochore and Argyll in the early 1300s, the Campbell kindred were not already great territorial lords in Scotland. He quotes their appearance on record as officials or being responsible for people on lands in the counties of Argyll, Dunbarton, Ayr, Perth, and Clackmannan. Here in 1308, at the Pass of Brander in Argyll, where Loch Awe passes westwards to the River Awe and the sea at Loch Etive, took place a battle which fundamentally shifted the patterns of power in Argyll for the next three centuries. In 1306, the 32-year-old Robert Bruce, having inherited his Scottish lands in Annandale and Carrick, finally sacrificed the future of his English estates to fight as an underdog for his claim to the crown of Scotland. He was of Norman, originally Norse, and Scots ancestry, and brought up in Scotland, where his father was Earl of Carrick. In staking his claim to the crown, Bruce challenged the power of the Norman Comyns, who were virtually in control of the governance of Scotland in those days. He also challenged the puissant and ruthless Edward of England, and the even more forceful international power of the Church, whose Pope had excommunicated him for his murder of the Red Comyn. And, on a personal level, he carried the burden that his wife had been imprisoned by his enemies. Those who supported Bruce on his expedition into Argyll in 1308 were the Earl of Douglas with his famous Lowland archers, Bruce's Highland kinsman Sir Neil Campbell and his cousin Sir Arthur Campbell with their Highland and Lowland followers, and Angus Og MacDonald with his men of the Isles. Angus was the younger brother of one of Bruce's opponents, Alexander MacDonald of Islay. Certainly the Douglas and almost certainly these others were with him as they entered the dangerous ambush in the Pass of Branda. Leading the men of Lorne in defending the pass were the descendants of Somerled's son Dougal, the lords of Argyll and the Isles. They opposed Bruce because the slain Red Comyn was brother-in-law to Alexander, their chief. Here, tradition holds, just west of the pass and beside the River Aw, are the graves of those who died that day in the Pass of Branda, where Bruce and his army defeated the lords of Argyll. That day marked the onset of the rise, first of Clan Donald and then of the Campbells, to positions of power in Argyll, and meanwhile, for the chiefs of the Campbells in Scottish national life. When Robert Bruce rewarded his supporters in years to come, the famous war leader Angus Og MacDonald of Islay was granted the other Isles, which had been forfeit by the lords of Argyll and the Isles, later known as the MacDougalls. Besides his likely presence with his men at the Pass of Branda, Angus then played a notable role in leading the right wing at the Battle of Bannockburn. He must have died in the late 1320s. There is a tradition of a marriage between a daughter of Caelanmore Campbell and Angus Og MacDonald. No proof has been found, and yet it was not unlikely in those days following the alliance under Bruce, and before the differing roles of the two families had set them in conflict at times. Angus Og's son John of Islay would be the first to call himself Lord of the Isles in 1353. From that year until the forfeiture of his descendant, the Earl of Ross, in 1493, as Lords of the Isles, Clan Donald would be the dominant power in the Isles of Argyll and beyond. John had gained control of Garmoran, Ardnamurchan and beyond, through marriage to his heiress cousin, Amy McCrory. However, for political reasons, he divorced her, but kept her lands and married a daughter of the Steward of Scotland, ancestor of the Stuarts. However, this link to the royal family did not restrain his descendants from attempting to overthrow the King of Scots. The uncertain loyalties of the Lords of the Isles towards the King of Scots would effectively increase the power of the Campbell kindred in mainland Argyll, whose kinship with the Bruces and their kinsmen, the Stuarts, would dictate the Campbell role as a buffer between the Islemen and the kingdom. From the royal point of view, the primary purpose of giving grants of land in Argyll to early Campbells was so as to have loyal kinsmen holding lands in strength in the west. Also, the forfeited Dougal lands were available, and the kings of Scots were never flush with cash and so tended to reward loyalty by granting lands. As kinsmen by descent and marriage of the Bruce and Stuart royal houses, the Campbell chiefs upheld the rule of the crown in the west and would be repeatedly rewarded with lands for countering the independent tendencies of the Islemen ruled by Clan Donald. The Campbell concentration of power in Argyll after 1308 can only be explained by the grants of land by Robert Bruce to Sir Arthur Campbell in Lorne and Benderloch, and by the grant of the barony of Loch Awe and Ard Scotnish to Sir Colin, son of Sir Neil Campbell, in 1316.
This is Dunstaffnage Castle, and as a castle it was originally built by one of the descendants of Somerled, the Lord of the Isles. Later, it came into royal hands following the Battle of the Pass of Branda, where Robert Bruce and his Campbell and MacDonald allies defeated the MacDougall Lords of Argyll. The MacDougalls went to the English court when they were defeated by Bruce, and Bruce put in a constable to be in charge of Dunstaffnage, and his name was Sir Arthur Campbell.
Although there are clear indications of earlier Campbell involvement in Argyll, these lands in Lorne and Benderloch had formerly been held by the Dougal Lords of Argyll. These, and the Lordship of Loch Awe, were greater holdings, although of less prosperous lands, than any held by Campbells elsewhere in Scotland. Following the Battle of the Pass of Brander, the castle of Inchconwell on Loch Awe came into Campbell hands as the messuage, or seat, of the Lordship of Loch Awe. If it had not been theirs earlier, it had likely been built by the Dougal Lords of Argyll and the Isles following the construction of Dunstaffnage. By the early 1300s, a simplified map of family influence in Argyll might look like this. In 1260, the McSweens had left Knapdale and Culslate and had gone over to Ireland, where they were to become famous as Gallagleich, or mercenary soldiers, employed at first by rival Irish kings and later against the invading English. Their former lands and castles of Skipness, and probably Castle Sween and much of Knapdale, had passed for a time into the hands of the royal Menteiths. Yet the McSween kindred of the Unrahan descent remained in Glasserie and Cowell, while the lands of Clan Dougal were, by 1316, largely in royal hands or granted to the third generation of the MacDonalds of Islay or the Campbells of Loch Awe. The Stuarts had not yet come to Lorne or Appin, and the MacIans were only now about to settle in Glencoe. The MacAllisters were newly settled in Kintyre, and the ancestors of the MacGregors in Glenorchy and Glenstray were not yet using that name. The MacCallums may still have been MacIsaacs, and many other local families of significance like the MacNaughtons, MacLeys or Livingstons, MacCorkadales, MacIntyres, MacKinnons were not yet much involved in national affairs, if they were already established. The Gillian ancestors of the MacLeans had recently come to Argyll and were about to be connected to the Lords of the Isles, perhaps through marriage. These were years of change among the leading families of Argyll. Sir Colin Campbell of Loch Awe, son of Bruce's ally Sir Neil and grandson of Sir Caelan More, established his family base at Inchconwell Castle, set up on an island about halfway down the 24-mile length of freshwater Loch Awe. He was succeeded by his son Archibald, whose son was Sir Caelan Yunkertach, Wonderful Colin, of Loch Awe, who died in about 1412. During the time of Sir Colin Yunkertach's, extensive lands came into Campbell hands by marriage. They were a good catch because of their royal connections and therefore their protective influence. And the more lands which came into their hands, the more farms could be found for younger sons who could therefore bring more local people to a field of battle in emergency. And so power tended to increase in a snowball effect. In those times, the marriage of a landed heiress was often granted by the king as a reward for loyal support.
In 1338, the descendant of those MacDougall Lords of Argyll who had escaped to the English court, came back to Scotland and was re-granted the lands of Lorne, which were part of the original Argyll lands of the family. And he was known as John of Lorne, or John Lord of Lorne.
John of Lorne lived here at Dunstaffnage. Clearly by his time, Sir Arthur Campbell, Constable of Dunstaffnage, was dead, and his son, ancestor of the MacArthur Campbells of Strachur, sold some of his lands in the area and gained others in Glendochart and Cowell to the east. John of Lorne must have been a very cosmopolitan man, and he appears to have operated rather independently of his MacDougal kindred, based here at Dunolly, only a short ride west of Dunstaffnage. His lordship did not pass to his MacDougal cousins. his heiress daughters married Stuarts, and the elder Stuart became Lord of Lorne. We will hear more of this family later. Not all the Campbell kindred had gathered in Argyll. One of the grandsons of Ceolan Mór is said to have married a lowland heiress in Ayrshire.
This is Loudon Hill in the lowlands of Scotland. And the lands of Loudon came into Campbell hands sometime early in the Middle Ages when a young Campbell came here and married the Crawford heiress. For these lands had been in the hands of the Crawfords for some years before that. And it was at Loudon Hill where Robert Bruce, during the wars for the independence of Scotland, defeated the army of Edward of England. And Edward's army is believed to have come around below the rocks, and on the right, Robert the Bruce and his Scottish forces, probably including Campbells, MacDonalds, Douglases, and so on, came rushing down off the hill and defeated Edward. And that was one of the first defeats of Edward's attempt to control Scotland.
Another family of Campbells held the lands of Menstrie and Sochi in Stirling and Clackmannanshire. These lands lay below the range of hills known as the Ochils, where Colin, 1st Earl of Argyll, would later gain the lands of Castle Campbell by marriage to the Stuart of Lorne heiress. One of these Campbells of Menstrie and Sochi would marry the heiress of Glenorchy, whose father was of the kindred later known as Clan Gregor in Argyll. Their daughter would marry her cousin Sir Ceolan Yunkertach, wonderful Colin of Lochore, so bringing the lands of Glenorchy to the Campbells by marriage in the late 1300s. Christina, heiress of Craignish in Argyll, also left part of her inheritance to her cousin, Sir Ceolan Yunkertach, wonderful Colin, when he was a young man in the 1360s.
This is Craignish Castle, and the lower part of what you see now was built after 1414. And no one really knows what the origins of the Campbells of Craignish were. They may or may not, in fact, be Campbells. But they do have a very interesting Campbell coat of arms, which is the Campbell Gyrony of 8, on the sail of a galley. And the galley is what is known as the supporter of the arms.
Christina, heiress of Craignish, had been the wife of MacDougall of Donolly, and later of MacNaghten of Frechlin, a castle near the north end of Loch Awe. When she was left a widow again, the MacNaghten heirs were granted alternate lands near Inverera. Frechlin and its Loch Awe side lands of Achlian and Duchley passed from Christina to another party, and so to Sir Ceolan Yunkertach, wonderful Colin, grandson of Sir Neil Campbell, who had fought beside the Bruce. At first, the MacNaghtens built a stronghold near Inverera, not yet a Campbell place, but they had a bad go of the plague and deserted that castle, now no more than a rickle of stones in the glen, and then built this handsome tower house of Dundarav on Loch Fyne, restored in the 19th century by Sir Robert Lorimer. This place was lost to the family through debt, not capture. The present head of the family lives in Ireland. Meanwhile, Christina of Craignish, clearly a lady of considerable energy, seduced and ran off with a young MacIver. Sir Colin Yunkertach appears to have passed Frechlin and its lands to his younger brother, Duncan Skjordnesach, called Duncan from Kilmartin, since he had been fostered there on lands which had been in Campbell responsibility since the previous century, an area then known as Ardscotnish. Duncan was almost certainly the ancestor of the MacConaghy Campbells of Inveraw, Lerags, and Stronchormig Glenfiachan. The original castle at Frochelan was, like Inchconnell, a walled enclosure, yet smaller, so that it could be roofed, forming a hall house. The tower house was built later by the Campbells of Inveraw.
This ruin is Lerigahoney, the place of the MacIvers. And there were more than one family of MacIvers in Argyll, and they appear to have been related, but this was the chief place of the MacIvers, and there was another family just north of here, which is now called Arduin. In their day it was called Asknish, and about the turn of the 19th to 20th century they sold Asknish to my grandfather, incidentally, and they moved to Loch Gair, which is down on Loch Fyne, not far from Loch Gilpaird, between Loch Gilpaird and Inverera. And although the MacIvers have used that name in the traditional pedigrees, they're descended from the O'Duin, the Campbells, and their coat of arms shows the Gyarany of Eight of the Campbells. So this is Larrigahoney.
On the march or border between Knapdale and Ardscotnish runs the modern Crinan Canal, constructed in the early 19th century. Here at Dunardry was the home of the MacTavishes, sons of Thomas, who appear as descendants of the O'Duin in the Gaelic pedigrees or oral tradition. Certainly, there was a Sir Thomas Campbell living in Argyll in 1296, and a traditional figure named Tavis Cor, said to be brother of the first MacIver in Argyll, may have been his ancestor. Although the naming of this stone at Kilmartin as MacTavish is clearly a more recent addition, this figure is a fine example of the padded armour of a Highland warrior of the 14th to 15th centuries. Sir Colin Yunkertach Campbell of Loch Awe lived at Inchconwell, and perhaps after his brother Duncan Skodnasach, he named his second son Duncan. The elder son, known as Slow John or Ian Annan, had a disability and so was not brought up to be the head of the family, but was granted the Craignish lands of Barbrek and was ancestor of the Campbells of Inverlever and Loch Awe. This shows that the use of the older Celtic style of inheritance persisted among the families in Argyll, where the feudal Norman style of primogeniture was not always followed if the eldest son was not suitable. Sir Colin's second son, Sir Duncan, grew up here at Inchconwell on Loch Awe and became a forceful character who moved the family further into the realm of national affairs. His father died in about 1412, and Sir Duncan made himself useful to the crown and was created First Lord Campbell of Loch Awe by King James II in 1445. Here at Inchconwell, Duncan, Lord Campbell, replaced the wooden structures which skirted the interior walls of the castle with a range of stone buildings, providing a magnificent hall where he could entertain on the scale expected of a Highland chief who was also a national figure. In his day, for the first time as Campbell of Loch Awe, he appears to be acknowledged as chief of the kindred by his kinsman, Campbell of Loudoun. However, the word clan had yet to be used in record about this and most other Highland families. One of Duncan Lord Campbell's brothers was the ancestor of the Campbells of Ardkinglas, across and up Loch Fyne from Inverera, and standing in the mouth of the pass from Loch Lomond and the Lennox. From them, among others, the Campbells of Ardentinney, the Campbells of Skipness and Isla, and the Campbells of Dunoon would descend. Another brother of Duncan Lord Campbell was ancestor of the captains of Dunstaffnage, whose descendant would be known in the Gaelic as Angus and Dun, the name Angus brought to the family through a marriage to a daughter of one of the MacDonalds of Islay. The family of the captains of Dunstaffnage suffered two fires, one at the castle and one at Dunstaffnage House, and lost many of their historic possessions. One cadet of Dunstaffnage married the heiress of the MacArthur Campbells of Strachur, Janet, daughter of General Campbell of Strachur, who had fought the Americans in the Revolutionary War. 3 years before he was made Lord Campbell, Sir Duncan of Loch Awe granted his half-brother Duncan More the lands of Duntroon in 1442. The place remained in the family until 1673, when it passed to a cousin due to debts incurred in a marriage contract. The place left Campbell hands in 1796, when sold to the MacCallum Malcolms of Bultalach, a neighbouring family who had made a fortune in the West Indies. Cadets of the Duntroon Campbells include those of Ashfield, Rudel, and Rashleigh. The Ashfield family became highly influential in Australia, where they founded the place which is now the capital, Canberra. Australia's military academy is called Duntroon, while the residence of the Governor-General is the old Campbell home with the crest of Duntroon on the gable. Duncan Moore of Duntroon was perhaps the youngest of the sons of Sir Caelan Yunkertach and brothers of Duncan Lord Campbell. This sculpture portrait of Duncan Lord Campbell is taken from his effigy, which survives in the family vault at Kilmun in Cowell. He married twice, both of them to Stuart ladies of the royal house. The one son of the first marriage was Archibald, who died before his father, but left a son, Colin, who succeeded his grandfather and was made first Earl of Argyll in 1457. The eldest son of Duncan Lord Campbell's second marriage was Sir Colin Campbell, founder of the family of the Campbells of Glenorchy, later Earls and Marquesses of Breadalbane. Shortly, we will take a closer look at this family. Another son was Dugald, ancestor of the Campbells of Auchinbreck, whose descendants we will mention later. Between them, the two Collins, the Earl of Argyll and his uncle of Glenorchy, began a period of expansion, which forged the Campbell kin into a clan and formed a base from which the Earls of Argyll would rise to power in the nation. What is remarkable is that without any military conquest, within a few generations, the Campbell chiefs were able to find land for younger sons who founded the families of Ardkinglas, Dunstaffnage, Duntroon, Glenorchy, Auchinbreck, Inveraw, Lerags, Stronchormig Glenfiachan, and Corda. These lands came to the Campbells through royal rewards for loyal service or through strategic marriages. The links of the Campbell chiefs to the crown and their consequent ability to protect their kindred also helped to ensure peace for their neighbours, which encouraged them to enter into marriage ties with them. This helped to maintain tranquility in the area, a factor little recognised today. The extraordinary growth of Clan Campbell over the following centuries is best illustrated by the family tree at Inverara Castle. Here we will take a swift break from the historical development of the kindred to look at this impressive diagram. Alastair Campbell of Airds is the son of war hero Lorn Campbell of Airds, who won a Victoria Cross while commanding the Argylls against Rommel in North Africa.
I'm standing in what is known as the Clan Room in Inverara Castle. And behind me on the wall, as part of the display there, is a chart, a large-scale chart, which was originally made for the Campbell clan gathering following the disastrous fire back in 1977. And it was only originally planned to last 2 weeks, but the Duke liked it and has had it installed in one of the public rooms in the castle. What it shows, or attempts to show, is the enormous size and spread of Clan Campbell. It's laid out as a tree with the central stem, which has got the names of the individual dukes on it, going away up into the top of the chart. In fact, the duke at the moment would be somewhere in the room above if I had kept it to scale and included him. And off this main stem come all the various Campbell families who have owned property, who are what are known as lairds, the gentry, the officers of the clan regiment, if you like. And each one of them is shown on the chart by the name of their property. As well as that, if they have a coat of arms, that is added. And the approximate date at which they came off the previous stem to which they're attached. On the chart as well, you have the date and the origin of their coat of arms. And in addition, if the particular family has come to a complete end and we know that they exist no more, the branch of the tree is shown coming to a dead end. If there are probably representatives of that family in existence, but we do not know their identity, there are leafless twigs. And if, in fact, we know who the present head of a family is, that is denoted by green leaves. And so it is possible to keep this chart updated and add or take away from it as one requires.
Here, Airds speaks in historical terms about the power brought by responsibility for people and land in the Middle Ages and after.
What I think is an interesting thing about this is it shows very clearly the enormous spread of Clan Campbell and its size and power, because land, of course, possession of land, is tremendously important, not only in producing wealth, but producing wherewithal to support men. And if you're talking about armed strength, land is a prerequisite on which to sustain these people. And there are something like 200 families shown on this chart, which is a number which is quite remarkable when compared with any other clan. Many of the perfectly respectable clans that we know would probably manage about 6 or 8 of these properties in their entire clan lands. And here you have this vast range of Campbells, the Campbells of Loudon and all their offshoots down in Ayrshire, the great branch of Glenorchy, later Earls of Bredorben, which is a tremendous part of the chart, stretching away into Perthshire, the Campbells of Corder, as well as Argyll, away up in Murrayshire, Nairn, and many others. And finally, round the edge are the coats of arms of either individuals or of younger sons who aren't the head themselves of landed families, but at one time or another have acquired a grant of arms.
We will now continue to explore the chronological development of the Campbell kindred. The third son of Duncan Lord Campbell, who must have grown up here at Inchiconwell, was Colin, later to become Sir Colin Campbell of Glenorchy. The lands of Glenorchy had come to Sir Colin's grandfather by marriage. The growth of the Glenorchy family would be the foremost example of the expansion of a branch of the kindred.
This is Kilchurn Castle, and it's the original home of the Campbells of Glenorchy, which is to the front of me. And behind me, the castle, the tower on the left-hand side, is the oldest part, which was begun in the 1440s. And the first Campbell of Glenorchy was a son of the Campbells of Lahore. And it was from here where the family lived for some time, that eventually they went what they called bursting yont, or busting forth, eastward into Perthshire. And there they, in cahoots with the MacGregors, who became their taxmen or tenants there, created the area called Bredolben, or Broad Alban, because one of the Glenorchy family decided that it was a very great thing to be able to ride from right clear across Scotland, he hoped eventually, on his own land from the Atlantic coast through the middle of Scotland.
The story is told that Kilchurn was hardly begun when Sir Colin left for a pilgrimage to Rome and the Eastern Mediterranean. His lady waited for 7 long years with no news, and was hard pressed by a neighbour to marry him, either a chief of the McCorkadales or one of Clan Gregor. Finally, she gave way, and as the feasting began at Kilchurn, a dark stranger came over the hill. Entering the hall, he asked the lady for a cup of wine, and when he returned the cup, it held their wedding ring. The dark, handsome stranger was Sir Colin himself returned. The descendants of Sir Colin continued to grow in power into the 19th century. Chieftains of Glenorchy would be raised to the Earldom of Breadalbin in 1681 and to the Marquisate in 1831. Two of the family, Black Sir Duncan of the Seven Castles and his grandson, Grey John, who was the first Earl of Breadalbin, were enormously ambitious in the territorial sense, which made them two of the 4 Campbells in history whose deeds have been taken, without further thought, to typify what was seen as characteristic of the whole kindred of the Campbells. Certainly, on 2 occasions, these Glenorchy Breadalbin chieftains had ambitions to supersede their elder cousins of Lochore's chiefs of Clan Campbell. Both Sir Duncan and Earl John were national figures whose remarkable power was based upon the large number of younger branches of their family for whom lands had been found, giving them responsibility for many followers. Notable among them were the Campbells of Lawers, crown land originally, granted on Loch Tay and later here near Creef. The Campbell tenants of Halidar at the head of Glenorchy later brought their own place in Perthshire and called it Halidar. The Campbell baronets of Aberuchill in Perthshire now live in their castle near Doon. The Campbells of Glenlyon were granted their lands by the Glenorchy family and built Megany Castle and later Duneaves in Glenlyon. The Campbell cousins at Fanab and here at Manee near Creef later had a descendant who bought Inveraw in Argyll from the Campbells of Inveraw in 1765. The Campbells of Edenample were granted the Tower House at the head of Loch Earn by Sir Duncan of Glenorchy. The Campbells of Barcaldin in Benderloch, meaning between the lochs of Etive and Creran, were granted their castle by Sir Duncan of Glenorchy also. Another son of Duncan Lord Campbell who grew up here at Inchconwell was Duncan, the ancestor of the Campbells of Auchinbreck in Cowell. Duncan's son gained Auchinbreck by marriage with a Lamont lady, and his younger son was granted Castle Sween, and his grandson also inherited Auchinbreck and was made a baronet in 1628. He was hereditary commander of Argyll's forces. His 18th century descendant, Sir James Campbell of Auchinbreck, was one of a Jacobite committee of 3, with his son-in-law Cameron of Lochiel and Murray of Broughton, who invited James the Pretender, father of Prince Charles Edward, to invade Scotland, resulting in the 1745 Jacobite Rising. Sir James lived in an earlier house here on Loch Gair. His descendants lived for a time at Kildallig in Kintyre, which they had bought, and they now farm in New Zealand. Here at Torblaren in Glasserey, one of the Auchinbreck family had descendants who founded the present cadet families of Kilmory, built by the Campbell Ords and now county offices at Knockbuie, and Kilberry in Knapdale, which is still inhabited by the family, the last of the Auchinbreck cadets in Argyll. In the 1400s, during the minority of Colin, 1st Earl of Argyll, his uncle and guardian, Sir Colin Campbell of Glenorchy, had a castle built for him here at Inverara, where the River Era meets the sea at Loch Fyne. In those days, the swiftest transportation was by galley, and the choice of Inverara was no doubt made for the advantageous sea routes from there into the heart of Scotland via Loch Fyne and the Clyde. Although in modern pronunciation the place is often called Inverary, the correct pronunciation in the Gaelic is Inverara.